All right, Jeff, we're back, and thanks for that update there, and thanks for Malik Scott for joining us. Now we're going to be joined by another great fighter, Peter Kid Chocolate Quillin. Peter, thanks for joining the Jeff Mayweather Show. You're with myself and Jeff Mayweather.
Hi, thank you for having me on.
Hey, appreciate it, man.
What's up, Jeff? How you
all
doing?
Well,
good. And yourself?
I'm blessed, taking one day at a time.
All right, well, thanks for joining us, Peter. You got a huge fight coming up here in just a couple weeks on February 9th against Fernando Guerrero. Give us a rundown on that fight and what you're looking forward to there.
Well, it's not as huge as my girlfriend. My girlfriend is like 300 pounds, so I don't know if she is that huge, but, you know. But no, let me stop playing. The fight is definitely huge, and I'm blessed to be on a great card. To be able to showcase my talents is just all a blessing, and you know, and I'm gonna keep on striving to be the best and be. I'm just good enough right now. I know you said I'm a great fighter, but I just think I'm good enough for right now until me building into that greatness, and that's what I'm doing every day.
Right. Well, now you're a Grand Rapids guy. What do you think of those Mayweathers? You know, they're the second best fighters coming out of Grand Rapids, right?
Well, you know what? I'm where I'm at because of the Mayweathers. You know, they inspired me to be, you know, a fighter, you know, and actually, you know, humble down and be able to get off the street to be able to go into a boxing gym. So I'm blessed to be able to be, you know, from the same city of such, you know, a great family of boxing, having a great family in boxing from Grand Rapids, you know. And Big Floyd is a big, big good friends of my father for so many years. So, you know, just to be able to, you know, just to be able to be from the same city and work towards my own things, man, it's a blessing.
Right. How long did you live out there in Grand Rapids?
I lived out there my whole life. My family moved us from Chicago. I was like 3 months, 6 months of age, and moved to Grand Rapids. Lived there until I was 18 years old. Moved to New York City after that. But my whole swag comes from Grand Rapids, Michigan.
Right. Now I'm from the Detroit area. I didn't get over there that much. But, you know, for the folks that don't know, you know, Grand Rapids is not huge. Just explain, you know, you touched on a little bit, but, you know, what the Mayweather name means to folks out there in Grand Rapids.
Man, you know, it's, you know, as far as boxing, you know, when everybody go into a boxing gym and fight, they try to fight like the Mayweathers from Grand Rapids, especially, you know, their name is such a big name there and everything. It's kind of sort of like what the DeBarges was. Coming out of Grand Rapids is in the same fashion, but, you know, for boxing, you know, having, like, Floyd going to the levels he went to, like, to be able to be from the same city of a guy that's went to height that you can never, ever imagine, and made some of the biggest purses in boxing, man, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's what, when it's time to set, when I set my goals, I set goals according to that.
Yeah. Now, Jeff, you know, what are your thoughts on, you know, a fellow Grand Rapids guy there and what Peter's been able to do so far in his career?
Well, I mean, I'm very proud of him. You know, I'm very proud of the fact that he is from Grand Rapids, and it just shows that no matter where you're from, you know, you can become, you know, you can follow your dream and make it happen. You know, and I got a chance to watch the fight when Peter won the title, and it was very impressive. You know, put the guy down 6 times or something like that. You know, the guy.
Yes, I knocked him down 6 times. But you know what's crazy? They don't even give me credit. They don't even give me credit for it. You know, only real boxing people give me credit. But let me tell you something. They're like, yeah, you got to get a guy to get up 6 times. I mean, what do you feel about that? I said, well, if he could have kept getting up, it was my job to keep knocking him down. That's all I train to do. And I'm very blessed to be able to have a fight underneath my record like that where, you know, a guy's never said, I never fought him. A guy won 15 amateur fights to be able to go out there and put on a performance with another black fighter like that, you know, and be able to come out unscathed and feel good about himself and go to another fight. I'm blessed with that. Now I'm back February 9th in the same stadium defending my belt against another top guy that's going to come to win, and I'm coming to, you know, hold my title with pride.
Right. Yeah, I want to get that fight in just 1 second real quick. Just first, I want to go back with your name. I know you're Cuban descent. Your father was born and raised there. Tell us a little about the name Kid Chocolate and where that came from. I know it came from a great boxer back in the 30s, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yes, 1920s, early 1930s. Kid Chocolate was one of those marquee names in New York City, kind of had a similar story. What I did, you know, moving out of my hometown to make my name in New York City. I went to New York and made a pretty name for my, good name for myself in New York, and the same thing what he did, but he was like selling out the stadiums and in the arenas there. So, you know, when I thought taking on a name, I ain't taking him to be disrespectful and saying I'm just that great. No, you know, you rarely hear about those great fighters from those cutback throwback fighters from the 20s, 30s, you know what I'm saying, like the Jack Johnsons, the Willie Peps, all those guys. You don't get to hear so much about them who paved the way for like guys like me to be able to be where I'm at. And then having similarities to him being from Cuba. My dad is 100% Cuban and having a lot of Cuban culture about myself, man. I rep Cuba very proudly. And, you know, I'm just blessed to be able to hold a name proudly and keep his name alive for the history books, keep his name alive for boxing fans, keep his name alive for boxing, period. Kid Chocolate was one of Mike Tyson's favorite fighters.
Yeah. Well, you probably didn't know this, but I believe Jeff, towards the end of Jeff's career, he actually fought him, right, Jeff? How did that fight go?
I'm sure I won because I don't remember him still being around.
Yeah, I was like, man, geez, he must have been boxing him in the grave or something.
Yeah, I must have been.
Yeah, Jeff started out the bare knuckles and then, you know, the 120 round things, and then he kind of moved on from there. But
when they never used to wear shoes.
So you know, we've mentioned the fight. You're fighting there in Brooklyn and at the Barclays Center. Tell us about, you know, fighting Fernando Guerrero. You seem like you and Danny Garcia are attached to the hip there, fighting the same card again here and in the same venue. Tell us about being able to fight there and kind of what's your second home.
I look at it like this. You always hear a guy that's, you know, when he's fighting in his hometown, he kind of got the pressures not to let the crowd down. But, you know, Fernando Guerrero is a demanding guy. He's, I think, originally from New York City, moved to Salisbury, Baltimore. And, you know, he's going to have – and he already's putting it on his own back to say that he wants to beat up the first Dominican middleweight champion out there, which I don't know if it was Julio Cesar Green that fought, and I don't know if he won a big title. But, like, you know, if this is what he says, then I know it's a very good reason to be a middleweight champion to, you know, be able to go out there and fight for his country. But, you know, what I don't want it to be, I don't want it to be a Cuba versus Dominican kind of fight, because I got so many Dominican fans and so many Dominican friends that, you know, I'm not going to detach myself from my relationship with them just over a fight. I just know that, you know, what makes a powerful champion is that he just don't inspire his own people. He inspires people outside of his race. So me inspiring Dominicans, me inspiring the black community, me inspiring the Cubans and, you know, all as a whole, you know, I think that's very special if somebody can do that. And, you know, like I said, I don't want to make it as a Dominican versus a Cuba thing, because you already know, you know, Cuba holds his records in boxing, and, you know, and I'm not saying anything super about that, but I'm just saying, as far as this fight goes, I know he has a good reason to want to come and take my belt. And all my job is to do is train like I've been training, which I trained it to destroy. So come February 9th, I got respect for him now, and when that bell rings, the respect is lost, and I'm going to fight him like a stranger and a thief that stole something in the night from him.
And what about being in that venue in particular, like in the Barclays Center there in Brooklyn? What's the atmosphere like there as opposed to fighting, you know, here in Vegas or, you know, a smaller venue somewhere else?
Well, you know, like I said, you know, it's one thing to be able to go all about and fight other areas, but, like, my name has been built in New York. And, you know, to be able to be part of such a new kind of thing, a new arena, you know what happens? You know, like when MMA came out, everybody thought it was going to overthrow boxing just because it was like a new thing to, you know, the fight world. But, you know, this arena, you know, you didn't have so many in the Mecca of boxing, which is the Madison Square Garden, to have something right over a bridge and be such a big kind of thing, man, like I said, it's like a blessing in disguise. And every time I go out there, I won my title there. I became in the history books to become a middleweight champion. Now every time I go out there, like I said, it's working towards greatness. And to be able to work towards my greatness in like an arena that's new that could be in the following years a good arena, who knows? And like I said, it's just about me fighting with my heart and fighting with my mind and putting everything together there in the Brooklyn and Barclays Center, hoping that I inspire everybody that's there in attendance. That's what's important to me.
And Jeff, you know, how important is it to you, do you think, for places like New York that, you know, were so prominent at one time but kind of, you know, faded the last few years, to come back and start to get back in the boxing business and put on great fights like this?
I mean, I think it's important. I think that, you know, of course, Vegas and Atlantic City has pretty much took over boxing at one point in time. But, you know, with the Barclay Center and, you know, I mean, it's going to be like, you know, boxing is back, you know. And, of course, you know, obviously they have intentions of having, you know, a lot of major fights there. So, I mean, they'll be back on the scene. You know, I mean, because New York at one point in time was really, really big on boxing. It was great, you know, to be able to say that you fought in New York, you know, or say that you fought at the Madison Square Garden, anything like that. But, you know, in the Barclay Center, I guess it's going to be probably more catered to boxing, more so than, you know, them having fights at the Garden anymore. But still, I think that, you know, it's going to bring boxing back in a big way.
Okay. And, Peter, what's your thoughts? You know, you kind of touched a little bit on Guerrero, but you know, a few years ago he was a huge prospect coming out. Then, you know, he lost to Grady Brewer there, and it kind of set him way back. But, you know, he's had a nice little run since then. You know, obviously he's got a lot to prove, and like I said, he has to be a little bit pissed off that you know when he once was thought of so highly, he's kind of been dismissed, and a lot of people are saying he's not a legitimate opponent for you. So what are your thoughts on him as far as you know, being a worthwhile opponent for you?
Well, you know, I think for his adversity, having one loss on his record is a test that he already knew what it felt like to be a loser. Because not losing for 28 fights, I never knew that feeling. And to be honest with you, I do not want to feel that feeling. So what I do, I go out there, hit the track. My willingness to learn, I actually, before my camp started, I went out to Vegas to work with Big Floyd, working some of my defense. You know, that's the part of me which advances me in this boxing, is to be able to have willingness to not, and I'm not going to act like I know everything. All I know is that I want to keep getting better. I want to keep inspiring my fans. I want to keep, you know, working towards greatness, such as like Cameron Nate. Like, so I know, you know, with Fernando knowing how it feels to lose, you know, he can't sound like every other opponent. You know, I don't want to hear him say, oh, I'm going to give him his first loss, because he's going to sound just like every other guy that told me that. You know what I'm saying? I just hope I don't hear that from him. But from what I'm hearing from him, he sounds like he really wants, you know, the belt. And that's what was going to do for boxing. It's going to bring the fans back into boxing. They want to see good fights. And as long as I'm prepared, and as long as he's prepared, I can not take anything away from him. But like I said, I do not want to feel like what it feels like to be a loser. That's why I train so hard. And I'm going to make sure that my hard work is put to use.
I think we got you in a bad patch, or you might be standing in a room that doesn't get good reception there. We break up a little bit, but we caught most of what you said there. I want to get a little bit as far as training. You're working with Freddie Roach. You know, he's, you know, a couple years ago he was, you know, the greatest trainer in the history of boxing. Then, you know, he had a tough little run here. You know, now he's catching a lot of flack. You know, what do you think of Freddie and as far as his abilities go? And just touch a little bit as far as, you know, how the perception of trainers is kind of rise and fall, you know, basically on the success of one fighter or one fight.
Well, you know, as you can see, I carry Eric Browning in my corner. At a time, Freddie, you know, burned me to wild card, and then he was going to train me, but he was just so super busy that I just needed the time, you know, that, you know, I thought I deserved, and I just chose to stick with his assistant, which was Eric Browning. And Eric became just my full-time trainer, so that's who I'm training with now. And, you know, I'm getting the time that I think I need to be able to progress and keep getting better. You know, as far as Freddie, I think Freddie knows really what he wants to accomplish, which he already accomplished in boxing. You know, but for right now, we're just going to focus on, you know, knowing what Eric Brown is trying to get me and what he's trying to get for himself. And, you know, I'm just blessed with being able to be training in the wild card and being with so many different guys and different faces and different fighters that want to try to be champions or champions and former champions. Is just a blessing to be. I'm a boxing fan, man. You know, besides being a participant in boxing, I am a boxing fan foremost. And to be able to be around all this, man, it's just a blessing. And I count my blessings. I'm making sure I stay humble.
And what's it like being in you know, as opposed to having like a superstar trainer, you know, Freddie Roach, as opposed to having the guy, you know, you're with Eric Brown. Advantages and disadvantages. I mean, it actually seems like it's got to be kind of cool when he has someone that's maybe a little under the radar and can devote more time to you and isn't quite pulled in so many different directions by so many different people.
Well, you know, you get guys like football coaches who have these understudies that work on them so many different years and all these different years and get to see everything but never had a shot to fame. And I think right now that's Eric Brown. He started with a shot to fame with me and being able to, you know, like I just came out of nowhere. You know, I mean, I've been making my name, you know, amongst real boxing people, but amongst the casual boxing fan, they didn't know who I was. So to be able to be, you know, have my name with Freddie Roach, you know, helps me, but also helps a guy like Eric Brown who really has been working in the shadows for so many years and now just able to come out of nowhere and be able to get his shine. And, like, he's a boxer. He loves boxing just as much as me. So, you know, like, you know, I'm just happy. You know, boxing always from every angle comes from some type of struggle. A fighter comes from a struggle. Good fighters always come from a struggle. You know what I'm saying? That's why the Midwest makes so many good fighters, because those are the most deprived areas in the United States. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, like Eric having a shot to fame with somebody like hungry as me that's eager to learn, the eager to get better, and he's, you know what I mean, we work in core size. So it's like when you in the marsh pitch going to war and you feel comfortable with your guy that's right next to you, you know he's going to die with you. That's Eric Brown for right now for me.
Okay. Now, Jeff, I'm just wondering, you got a Grand Rapids boy here. What happened to you? Why were you in there training him?
What do you mean why I ain't train him? He chose me want to train him. Most important thing is
that don't take away
I'm a big fan.
So regardless, I never trained with the Mayweathers. I have been training with them because of what how much they did inspire me. They just put so much. You know, I don't think they know how much they inspired me to be where I'm at right now. So I have to give them a lot of credit for that. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, with that being said, you know, I give credit due when it's time to give credit. You know what I'm saying? And that, I have to give Jeff and his brothers and everything who's just been showing me so many blessings, so many happiness with me, man. I'm blessed to have them, man.
You know, what do you think about some of the big names in your division? You know, how you match up with some of them? You know, like I said, you've kind of really, really come on here the last couple of years and really gotten your name out there. But, you know, you have some other huge names out there in the division, the Sergio Martinez's, the Triple G's there, and people like that. How do you think you match up against the other champions? Who else am I missing? Who's the other champion?
I mean, you know, of course they're all good fighters. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I think they're all wonderful fights for me, and I think they all will be fights that will be made soon, and I think it all comes in time. This fight, I'll probably have an X on my back, you know, when these guys wanting to fight a guy like me. I just look at those guys like food, man. Eventually, I'm going to eat them, you know what I mean? And, you know, I just train hard and be prepared for any one of those guys. I know some guys who take a lot of credit and saying, oh, you know, you don't want to fight this person. I don't make my fights. I never, ever been a matchmaker. I never, ever was trying to do the business part of boxing. The only thing I ever wanted to do was be a fighter, and that's how I act. I don't say I don't want to fight him. I don't say that. I just, when they come and bring me these fights and these challenges, they bring the fights that is fair for me and is good for boxing. I think that's what's most important, and I think those fights will eventually be made. You know what I'm saying? Like the guy, some of the guys like Sergio Martinez, who wants to be considered the best in the world, and, you know, and if he don't think I deserve a shot yet, then, you know, I can't take anything away from him. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to call him scared. I'm not going to say any of those things because I don't know him personally to know that. I just know that, you know, eventually time will come and time will keep ticking. And, you know, either he going to get older or the fight will never happen or the fight may happen. It's just, I'm just be happy with whatever God gives me. I'm just blessed being a champion right now, and I'm going to enjoy that success, and I'm going to defend my belt with pride until it's time to get some of them other belts.
Do you have a dream opponent? Is it Martinez or maybe, you know, if you're thinking strictly money, I guess, you know, Martinez and Chavez Jr. are probably the biggest paydays out there. But do you have someone in mind that's kind of your dream opponent?
Well, you know, I love to fight. Yeah, right now, let me just say this. If I go over the head of Fernando Guerrero, then I'm looking too far in the future. I didn't know that number one priority is Fernando Guerrero. to be, you know, focused on. That's who I'm focused for this whole camp. It's been him, and I'm looking at him. I see him every morning. I fight the fight every day in my head. So, you know, I'm training to have a victory. But, you know, it's other names like Daniel, who had two belts. You know, it's Triple G, of course, that, you know, is a superstar fight. And, of course, Sergio Martinez, which, you know, my eye's been on for so many years now. And, you know, I never had my shot to get at him. And, you know, like I said, all those fights could be made in the future. And I'm going to just keep focusing. I'm going to keep fighting. And I'm going to keep my hands up, my chin down. I'm going to keep a smart mind. And I'm going to fight with my balls, because that's what I'm fighting with.
Now, that's what it was.
Yeah, you know, it's a lot of fighters, man. They fight only with just some of their tools. They fight with their hands. They fight with their feet. They fight with their mind. They fight with their chin. They fight with their heart. I fight with everything. I fight with my feet, my hands. I use my mind to be a smarter fighter. I got a chin if I ever need it. I fight with the balls when we in the trenches. You know, so I'm just a complete fighter, and I'm working towards greatness. And how I do that is just keep having that willingness to learn, and just know that God has got a mission and plan for me, and I'm just humble with my faith, and, you know, nobody can tell me nothing. None of the things that I got in life right now, nobody ever gave it to me. I had to fight for it, and that's where I'm at because of my hard work. I only got 15 amateur fights. I don't have no amateur fights. I only got one regional title, which is a ringside national tournament that I won in 2002. You know, but other than that, no Golden Glove titles, none of that. I just, you know, came out the woodwork. It's just been a fan of boxing. It turned into a dream, and I started setting my goals, and I've been accomplishing my goals ever since.
Now, we talked a little earlier with Malik Scott about, you know, some of the problems with boxing and as far as, you know, building it back up and the difficulties in making, you know, the bigger matches, you know, and you touched about, you know, like the fight Martinez. You know, if you were the boxing czar, what, you know, what kind of changes would you make to the sport that would make it more fan-friendly and get you guys to be able to get in there with the best against each other?
The media. The media is sometimes right as perspective of being a fighter themselves. You know, instead of just writing positive stuff about boxing, you don't see us enough on ESPN. You hear about the colleges and everybody, what they're doing in college, but you don't hear about the guys that's up and coming who's fighting on their own network. They ain't even talking about boxing no more. So I would just say the media got to play a big part, getting, you know, not write so much bad stuff, because that's what makes the sport get a black eye, is when you write so much negative stuff. It's already like a super, I mean, look at football. Football, full contact sport, people being hurt for life. You know what I mean? You know, you guys got really messed up. And then they talk about boxing, where guys like Muhammad Ali, Sugar Ray Leonard, who's been on the cover of Time. You know, these kind of guys, these are, and you know, boxing is one of the oldest sports, man, you know, and they don't give us no respect. It's because some people, you know, that never had a fight in their life will go out there and write some negative stuff and, you know, have a bunch of people following that and make a little sense. But, like, you can't make sense of boxing. To be a boxer, you got to be a little crazy a little bit. And, you know, at the end of the day, it's my life. It's my life. You know, if you think about life, the reason why boxing, people can relate to boxing so much is because life is just like a boxing match. It's a fight. And you're fighting every day to be better. You're fighting every day to be the best at your job. You're fighting every day with your wife and trying to work it out. It's a fight, and that's why everybody can relate to a fight. So if everybody can look at it like that, and instead of looking at it like, oh, this guy is scared. Like, you can't tell somebody that's willing to step in a rope and fight another guy and look him in the eye and fight him and call him scared. That's not scared, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, like with me, I just know that I'm just blessed, and I try to be less involved with what people write about me or what people say about me, because it's getting to the point where I'm just too emotionally attached to that kind of stuff. I got a guy hit me on my Twitter every day telling me why I don't fight GGG. It's because it don't make sense for me right now. If the money ain't there, what the fight is compared. I know he's a serious fighter. Yeah, there's some things in the fight that he may do good, and there's going to be a lot of things that I do great. You know what I'm saying? I don't think he's going to be able to beat me. I just think the money don't make sense, and I think the boxing people that I work with, like the Golden Boys, the Al Haymans, and my management team, they're going to advise me on the best opportunities out there for me to make sure that the years that I invested in boxing, I'm going to get that back with these fights that's coming up. You know what I'm saying? So, like I said, I'm just keeping my blessings alive and keeping my faith in God grounded, and making sure that, you know, when I step out there, I'm fighting with my heart. and my balls.
Well, it's a good thing. It's a good thing you're not paying attention to the negative stuff, because Jeff, let me tell you, Jeff rips on you constantly every week on the show. He's always talking bad about you. So glad you're not paying attention
too much. That's
all
love, man.
No, the one thing he mentioned earlier, Al Heyman. This is he's also the advisor for Guerrero, right? And this is the first time I believe he's put two of his own guys together. So anything interesting coming out of that?
Well, you know, like boxing is, if you get it confused, like if I get it confused with the fights I used to have on the corner of the street, you know what I'm saying? I'd be messed up, but, you know, it's a business. So at the end of the day, that's how I kind of view this. You know, when you sign a contract, ain't no emotional involvement can be in that. Like, I'm signing a contract, and I'm just like, oh, man, I got to beat him up. No, I don't think like that. I'm like, damn, you know what? I'm going to sign this contract, I'm going to train to win, and I'm going to get paid. You know, that's called a job. You know what I mean? A lot of these guys, probably when they fight me, when they about to fight me,
oh,
I'm sorry, yeah. When they about to fight me, you know what they do? They kind of shivering and shaking a little bit when they sign the situation for their career. You know, I was like, I can't say that about Fernando Guerrero, but all I know is that I'm going to be ready February 9th to go ahead and put my stake in boxing.
All right. Last thing I'd like to cover with you both, actually. I'll start with you, Jeff, and then I'll get with you, because at some point, Peter, you're going to have to go through this. Shane Mosley just announced that he's coming back and fighting Paulo Malignaggi. Jeff, your thoughts on him coming back? He's catching a lot of flack. You know, he was 0-3-1 his last four fights. Thoughts on him coming back, and does he have anything left to offer?
Well, I mean, to be honest, I would just put it this way. I think that taking the fight with Malignaggi, because of the fact that he doesn't have punching power, is a safe fight, you know. Not saying that he will win or whether he'll lose, but it's safe. He won't get hurt, you know. And that's the reason why I think that he's coming back to fight Malignaggi. And not only that, I mean, it's a fight in which there's a title at stake. So, I mean, he's putting himself back in a position to, you know, win a world title and, of course, make a decent, you know, a nice payday. So, I mean, it makes sense, you know. But, I mean, if you're going to come back to fight any champion out there, you're taking less risk with somebody that's going to, you know, that's not going to hurt you. You know, I mean, they might beat you, but they're not going to physically hurt you.
I think we just had a Jeff Mayweather Show first. There's dogs barking in the background, and it's not my dog. So,
yeah,
great to see for the show.
I'm in Holly in the hills, and I'm trying to make sure that coyotes are
there go
barking.
My dog. there go
oh, that's
my
your dog
right
in the back,
you.
Yeah. They must have heard the dogs in my background.
Yeah, no. My wife comes home every single time in the middle of the show, so without fail.
No, you want me to tell you what's crazy is because when I was on the phone with y'all, I'm standing on the corner of a street, and I seen a lady she fell really hard, and I just heard her over there crying. So I walked over there, and I said, "Miss, are you okay?" And she was like, "Yeah." She cool, and then the dog started barking at me.
All right. And then the last thing, you know, your thoughts on what we just said about Mosley in particular. And then, you know, how do you think that, you know, you never know until you get there, but at some point it's going to come to the end of your career. Do you have kind of an exit strategy? And how do you think that's going to play out? It's going to be really hard for you to walk away? Or, you know, I don't know. I'm not a fighter, so I know that the competitive spirit will always be there, and it's hard to walk away when you got another good 50 years left in your life after your last match.
What? I think at the point, when I'm at that point, then I hope that I'm surrounded by good people, my friends and my family, who's going to, you know, have me truly at heart. And at the same time, I hope that I'm just thinking in the clear head and I'm not thinking a lot of emotion. I don't like to make decisions out of emotions. I think at that time, you know, God is going to show me at the time what I should be doing, you know. And it's kind of hard to say that when you got a guy like Bernard Hopkins who go out there and just try to put his best foot forward and became a one of the oldest champions ever made, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, like I said, it's kind of hard to believe what the odds are when you can, you know, break all and beat all the odds that's on you, you know what I'm saying? So that's what makes boxing such a special sport is that you can, you know, one punch can always change a whole fight, and then that no matter how old you are. But like I said, it's just all about health, and if you being smart about your health and being able to perform, like, you know, with the younger guys who's coming out and they coming out the, you know, prove themselves and fight with their heart out, you know?
And so, you know, obviously maintain your championship, but what are your you know, your career goals? You know, what do you have left to accomplish? What do you, you know, what going forward? What are the things that you want to, you know, do in the sport before you eventually hang them up?
Well, I got to break some records. I got to figure out which, when I'm able to break, what kind of records I'm able to break, and just work towards that now, and just defending my, like I said, my belt with pride, and be able to accomplish more in boxing. You know, who knows what it might be. So, you know, the sky, I go beyond the sky now. The sky was the limit before when you become a champion, and then once you're the champion, you got to go beyond the sky to be accomplished whatever you want to accomplish. I want to be in touch with my community a little bit. You know, it's a lot of things happening in Grand Rapids. God rest. A young guy's name is Anthony. You know, it's my mother's friend, best friend at a, you know, years back. Her son has been just found in the alley, and somebody murdered him. You know what I'm saying? I just got uh-huh. the word this morning that he just got killed. So, you know, I just want to get back. You know, so much when I come from Grand Rapids, you know, it's so much stuff that makes you want to get out of that place and never go back. But I think where I'm at, where I'm at now in my life, I got to be able to be a voice for, you know, what's going on, and just go out there and just show them that I do care, and I just think that everybody should work towards where they want to go. And I'm gonna look to be doing that more in the future for myself.
Yeah, it's always great to see the, you know, the fighters that do well for yourselves. You know, want to, you know, give back and do what you can for the community. I know we had Andrew Durrell on a couple weeks ago from Flint, which, you know, obviously has a rough time over there as well, and, you know, he's concerned about the community. So it's always nice to see you guys, you know, really showing concern for the place you came from and, you know, and the hard times that they're going through. You know, Jeff, just final thoughts before we wrap up the show here. You know, you gave your thoughts a little bit earlier, but just, you know, where you think he is now and where he can go to in the future.
I mean, you know, it's pretty much like you said. I mean, the sky's the limit. I mean, he's already in the history books. You know, now it's time to try to add more history. And, you know, like I said, I mean, I met Peter a long time ago, and I think that he probably, I don't even know if he had his first pro fight at that time, but I know he didn't have very many fights. And, you know, I mean, very, very nice guy, you know, and it's kind of funny that I found out while he was in New York that he actually was from Grand Rapids, you know. So I think I was out there with Shannon Briggs at that time. I think we were having like a press conference for some fight. I'm not sure what fight it was, but.
No, I think he was with the Russian kid. What's his name? The softball.
Oh, Sultan. I was there to fight Shannon then.
Where were you at?
Was it in Bragamoff? What's his name?
Yeah, Bragamoff. Yeah, so
Sultan and Bragamoff.
It was the fight, Shed. No, it was the fight. Because we didn't fight.
He fought Klitschko.
Was it Klitschko? Oh, okay.
Yeah, he fought
okay,
the Klitschko,
yeah,
brother. Yeah, he was over there. Yeah. I fought on the undercard of that fight.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I just remember that. That's when.
You've been a.
You know, I had really pushed.
That's how you know Jeff is around. It's just everywhere. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You know, hey, and. No, the one thing also, he got even more Mayweather attachment. Because my niece made you one of your outfits.
Yes, he did. Yes, Tish definitely made my, what you call it. And actually, Tish, her daughter, Kwe Kwe, her and my brother got a kid together that I'm hoping that my brother become more of a responsible young man and start becoming a man more than, you know what I'm saying, than when he running around in the streets trying to, I don't know what he's looking for, but, you know, the blessings is that, you know, everything can be kept in the family, and I'm just blessed to be able to have, you know, these wonderful people in my life and be able to just promote greatness on me and just shine me with their blessings and with their knowledge. And, you know, that's what it's all about, is spreading the love and sharing it.
You know, actually, I want to ask you one more question. Just touching it. Oh, go ahead, Jeff.
No, I said, this is a very positive man. I like it.
Yeah, it's just got
to
touch on that.
We can't go nowhere if we wasn't like that, man. You know, I just learned that, especially where I'm from, you know, the only people that don't ever get to go nowhere is the negative people, you know. And as soon as I start changing my life for the better by being just a positive person, I noticed that I was my own prisoner. I was just let release myself. And I was more happy about life and more enthused about what I was able to get and more people that I can get to meet and see and meet.
Yeah, I was gonna ask you about that. You know, how important was boxing and that kind of thing to you? You know, because you know, coming from a difficult situation where a lot of people can go the wrong way, was there something that kept you from? Was it boxing that kept you straight and becoming positive and doing good things with your life? And you know, if you didn't have boxing, was there a chance that you could have went and you know and been you know done negative things in your life and had a rough time?
Well, I have to thank God for all that because He gave me a powerful will. He put boxing in my life. And, you know, and I'm just blessed with having him in my life. And, you know, he always, you know, I'm just humble, man. You know, like, I'm very blessed to be where I'm at. I don't even sometimes give myself enough credit sometimes, you know. So, you know, I'm just, like I said, blessed, and I count my blessings. I'm just a happy guy, you know what I mean? I'm just happy with what I accomplished in life. And I know I still got more work to go. And I'm working hard, like, you know, like I never worked before. And that's what I'm learning, that, you know, every time you step out there, you got to take the work level up a little bit more just to accomplish where you want to be at. You know, when it's only a certain amount of people that want to go to the top of the pyramid, and, you know, the top of the pyramid is cold, it's lonely, and it's a place where only you can understand. And, you know, I think that's where I'm headed at, you know, and I think God is going to put me there for a reason to be able to inspire people and just keep my blessings showered upon others and sharing the blessings.
You know, and probably, you know, keeping you away from Jeff probably also was a good thing that kept you in the straight and narrow in your life, too. So that was probably a positive thing. Right, Jeff?
Yeah. Good weed.
Good weed. You got,
now,
well,
I could be
a
troublemaker myself. Jeff should probably be careful.
All right, well, Peter, it's been great having you on the show. We're looking forward to February 9th. It's going to be you and Fernando Guerrero, also Danny Garcia and Zab Judas. It's going to be a great card there in Brooklyn. Tell the folks where they can keep up with you on Twitter and all that kind of good stuff.
Yes. No, first, if you can't get me on none of my Twitter or Instagram, you can go to my website, www.dogkidchocolate.com. They got all my tabs for my links. But if not, go to Twitter, ChocolateKO. Or Kid Chocolate, I'm sorry. You can also add me on Instagram, Instagram/Kid Chocolate. What's most important is that y'all tune in to the fight on Showtime February 9th, seeing me defend my belt. And y'all should see my 300-pound girlfriend sitting ringside. She's going to take up about four chairs, and I'm going to buy all the tickets for those ringsides there. But thank y'all for having me on, and I'm blessed to have y'all bring me on.
I appreciate it. Jeff, anything else you want to add before we let them go?
Not really. That's pretty much it. I can sign them off.
All right, thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I'll say it before you sign them off, but yeah, just thanks so much for joining us. We were looking forward to the fight and love to get you back on, you know, further down the road after you have a few more wins under your belt. Thanks so much for joining us. Appreciate it. And then
yes,
I'll turn it over to Jeff.
All right.
Well, it's time to go, and it's time for me to say my customary bye. Bye.
All right, Peter, thanks so much for joining us tonight. All right, that's going to about do it. Had Malik Scott on the first half hour. Thanks so much for him. And then we had Peter Quillin right here. Great guest tonight, Jeff. Any final thoughts as we wrap up the show?
Well, no, I think both guys were great in their own way. I mean, I think Peter is very positive, has a great outlook on his future. And I think that Malik is, you know, one of the rare guys out there that's willing to, you know, to take some risks. And, you know, and basically, like he said, I mean, even some of the guys that he's calling out are his friends. And like he said, some of these O's need to go, you know, because, you know, he don't know necessarily whether it's the promoters or whatever case may be. But, you know, he just said that, you know, he thinks that, you know, that these guys should fight and find out who's the best American.
You know, it's kind of interesting. They both had different outlooks on the sport. You know, you had, you know, two totally different looks at it. You know, you had Malik Scott saying, you know, who cares about the money? Just get in there and fight. And then you had, you know, Peter, you know, saying, you know, I'd fight Triple G, but the money's not right. So, you know, and not saying one's right or wrong, but you definitely had two different outlooks on boxing and how to handle a career.
No, exactly. I mean, and like I said, I mean, everybody's different, and that's what we got a chance to see tonight. We got a chance to hear tonight, rather. You know, you have two guys that, you know, because Malik was kind of more, you know, he was more like in the zone, and he was, you know, basically, he was on a rant about the things that are going on, and I can kind of sense that, you know, with him, because it's been a long, long time for him, you know, for now to finally get some just dues or to get some, you know, some notoriety, you know, in his career. You know, he's at 35-0. I mean, he should have already been fighting for a world title. But, you know, for some reason it never happened. But now with, you know, with NBC being, you know, back in the boxing business, I mean, people going to know who he is.